Chairman of the Board, Professor Tauber, friends, faculty, and guests, welcome back. I hope you had a good lunch, and I hope you found the discussions interesting this morning. Now, just before lunch, we celebrated the anniversary of German-Israel relations. And later on today, we will hear more about the German-Israel relations. But before we begin, we have another film about a faculty, which I'd like to share with you.
עובדים על איך המוח שלנו מגבש זיכרונות של פחד, כשהמטרה הסופית שלנו היא לדעת איך למחוק את הזיכרונות של פחד. מגיל 8 אני חלמתי להגיע לצרפת, ולכן מבחינתי צרפת היא המקום הכי מרגש מבחינתי. כל פעם מחדש שאני מגיעה לצרפת אני מתרגשת מחדש. זה היה בחודש יולי בשנה שעברה, נבחרתי להיות ראש חוג סגול לנוירוביולוגיה. אחרי הצבעה אספתי את פתקי הצבעה והבנתי שהגעתי הרבה יותר רחוק משאי פעם חלמתי. הגעתי לאיזשהו כנס באיטליה ונסענו קבוצה מאורגנת לטיול מסוים באיזשהו מקום גבוה. ושם בירידה הבנתי שאני לא יכולה לרדת כי יש לי פחד גבהים. ואז ישבתי על הרצפה וזחלתי את כל הדרך למטה וכולם חיכו לי למטה בסבלנות ואף אחד לא צחק עליי. אבל אני צחקתי על עצמי. אני גדלתי באוניברסיטה, עשיתי את התואר הראשון שלי, השני והשלישי, ואני עובדת פה מזה 10 שנים יותר אפילו. אבל המקום שאני הכי אוהבת זה המשרד שלי. משם משתקף דרך החלון שלי הנוף הכי יפה, ויש את העץ כליל החורש שאני רואה אותו בכל העונות שלי. אין לי מושג, אבל אני חושבת שיש כאלה שחושבים עליי דברים טובים, ויש כאלה שחושבים עליי דברים פחות טובים. רציתי, הייתי מאוד נאיבית, אז רציתי להיות שגרירת ישראל בלבנון. לפני שהתחלתי ללמוד באוניברסיטה, עבדתי במוזיאון היפני במרכז הכרמל, וביליתי את כל הזמן שלי מתקנת את הדלתות שעשויות מנייר האורס הילדים היו קוראים. אני אוהבת לצלם, אני אוהבת להיות מהצד השני של המצלמה ולא מהצד הזה של המצלמה. השאיפה שלי מבחינת המחקר שלי הוא לתרגם את מה שאנחנו מוצאים בחולדה לבני אדם בכדי לעזור להם לשכוח את הזיכרונות של פחד והזיכרונות הטראומטיים שלהם. אולי עוד 20 שנה כשאני אצא לפנסיה אני להגיע לעיירה מסוימת בצרפת ולרקוח ריבות ואולי לעשות מפעל לריבות ביתיות. אני עשיתי את מה שאני אוהבת לעשות, ואני חושבת שזה הטיפ שלי לכולם, לעשות את מה שאוהבים לעשות.
So I'd like to introduce myself before we continue. My name is Dr. Karen Omri. I'm a lecturer in the Department of English and English Language and Literature, where I focus on American studies, on popular culture, and on literature. And as an academic, I know that in this age of technological mobility, which my slide seems to be engaged in, forgive me. Let's see. Is this it? Let's try this. Okay. It is only through interaction, through ongoing dialogue, and through a constant flow of information, and through help from technical support, with others that we at the university, in Haifa, and in Israel can hope to attain the excellence that we pursue. So today's topic is, of course, of interest to me, as it must be important to you. Now, it's been an incredible day focusing on some very real issues. Chairman of the Board, Professor Tauber, it's my honor to invite you to the podium to summarize the day's discussions. I'll fix this. Okay, let me try and fix this for you.
I had the opportunity of attending all 3 panels, and I would say that each of them was lively and very interesting. I'd like the moderators of each of the panels to give maybe a 5-minute summary of the major points that were made in their discussions. Following that, I think what we'll do is we'll have Manfred deliver your longer comment. And after your discussion, we'll open the floor to questions and answers and comments, okay? So Mark, would you kindly take the microphone? Mark Udoff, a member of the Board of Governors, chaired the session on Israel and North America.
Fred, thank you. Excuse me. We had a quite lively discussion. It was typical for Israeli and Jewish audiences. For every question, we got 10 or 15 observations from people, and it was enlightening. I don't know there was any coalescence around any particular point of view. The first part of the session was on the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement in the United States. Part of that discussion was Professor Avraham was there, the Department of Communication. He's head of the Ambassadors Online Program. I can't do justice to the program, but it's a program that seeks to counter the pro-boycott, anti-Israel movement in the United States and elsewhere online, and sends ambassadors to various places. I think they're sending 30 ambassadors, if I remember correctly, and had 300 or 400 applications. I talked about the boycott movement in America. It's very strong. At the University of California, 6 of the 10 campuses, the student governments have voted for the boycott movement. There are other places like at, I believe at Northwestern and elsewhere where that has occurred. The tide seems to be turning a little bit. There have been more than 20 boycott resolutions that have failed. There's a great deal to be said, but I won't say it all in the summary. There was a lot of agreement around the table. One of them is that we have to be, we cannot be amateurish in trying to blunt the pro-boycott movement. We need to have experts and communications firms and polling. We need advocates on the campuses. We need faculty networks. You just can't sit back and let it happen. We had a discussion about how much of a threat is this. Well, it's apparently not an existential threat at the moment. No American university has adopted the boycott position. But as I told the group, I come from a paranoid people. And I worry about the anti-Semitic narrative on many campuses. And I worry that someday they may be in the majority. And I worry that someday these young men and women, if we don't try to blunt this message, will grow up and hold influential positions in America and will not be sympathetic to Israel. Other things that we discussed is, apart from getting organized, is that one thing you need to understand is that the pro-boycott position has become the progressive issue du jour of the day. That there is a coalition, and that unfortunately, African-American groups and Hispanic groups, Asian-American groups, gay and lesbian groups, there tends to be a unity in opposing, in trying to embrace a boycott of Israel and impose sanctions. And that is a real problem. And we have to figure that out. The historic alliance between, say, the civil rights movement and these groups and the Jewish community is, at least on the campuses, is somewhat in tatters. So that was another issue that we discussed at great length. And I would just say, not out of ideology, but just out of pragmatism, if you're going to counter these movements on American campuses, it has to be from a centrist or slightly left of center position. If you swoop down with a lot of money and a sort of conservative agenda, it will fail. It will just flat out fail. So we finished the discussion of that. Then we had a dazzling discussion. We had on U.S.-Israel relations. We had Professor Ophira Ayalon, and she spoke about climate change. She did all of it in 7 or 8 minutes. And she talked about energy dependency, fossil fuels and alternatives, and various relationships with the United States. And her feeling, I think, was that it's a fertile area to try to improve relations between Israel and the United States, because it is acknowledged that many of these areas, like in irrigation and in wastewater and so forth, Israel is a leader, and that is a starting point for those discussions. We had a very interesting lecture from Professor Ben-Zvi on U.S. foreign policy, and he gave us a sort of theoretical framework, and he said you might think about that relationship in two ways. There's the sort of strategic relationship, which is historical and which is the normal stuff of relationship among countries, and then there's the special relationship, which was based upon a commonality, a dedication to pluralism, democracy, and democratic values. And what he said was that because of the way that Israel is being cast as a settler nation, an imperialist nation, an occupy nation, a violator of human rights, that the special relationship was eroding in American Israeli relations, and that he had fears that it might over time erode the strategic relationship as well. The third speaker was Professor Wasmel Manner. I'm sure I butchered his name. And he had 7 or 8 minutes to analyze all of politics in the United States, who will win the next election. It was a tour de force. Basically what we talked a lot about, and which is very worrisome, is that Israel is increasingly seen as a wedge issue and not as a bipartisan issue in the United States. That if you look at support, he estimated, I think, that something like one quarter of the at least the Democratic caucus in Congress, were not sympathetic to Israel anymore. In general, again, this phenomena of Israel not being viewed as a progressive cause, but Israel being viewed as, in a way, the anti-progressive cause, that there seems to be a decline in support in the Democratic Party and in progressive circles generally in the United States. We ran out of time. We would have had solutions to all these problems. I think I'll step down before you question me about that. Thank you.
Professor Yudof is a professor of law, former president of the University of Texas, former president of the University of California, and I am sure is the expert on moderating such discussions. We also have a professor of law from the Hebrew University of Jerusalem, Michael Cariani, who will summarize, he's a member of our board, summarize the discussion between Israel and our most immediate neighbors in the Middle East. Thank you.
Before I come up with one short sentence to summarizing all what was discussed, actually is that the Middle East is much more complicated than it seems. I'm not really innovating anything, but I think what we came out with from the discussions concerning Iran, Turkey, Syria, Egypt, the Palestinian Authority, or Palestine, as it is known in internationally by many states today, is that each of these states, each of these countries have a special relationship in terms of Israel. And the way Israel is dealing with many of these countries, some of the experts said that it is not handling the relationships that well. That much more thought should be put in terms of Israel's foreign policy in handling the affairs with these states.
Uh,
In terms of the future, it wasn't that optimistic in terms of how things are developing. but yeah, if we put into action the global characteristic of each and every conflict that happens locally, I think we can find some optimism. Comparing the global with the local is very interesting. How things are developing, you are seeing the locality more insulated from the world at large. Different sections in the West are developing more in cooperation. Europe is an example, North America is another example, but the Middle East is disintegrating. It's really falling apart, and Syria came up as one very powerful example in terms of a state that was powerful just about 5 or 6 years ago, and now it's evaporating. It's becoming a number of states, if at all it can be still called a state. So in terms of what is happening, it's not that encouraging. But then we should also ask, would that last forever? Or is there something in the future that lies that would be directed in a different course of action? It's not easy to predict. And in Hebrew, there's a very nice saying that predicting something has been given as a privilege for the fools. But I'm at least certain that no local conflict can stay to be local. Every local conflict is becoming more of a global conflict. What's happening locally is always influenced of what's being done in the UN, at the EU, and the international pressure is something that is an ingredient of the local politics in Israel as well as in many other places. So we cannot disconnect the local from the global. And hopefully, if the global interaction in many places has been a kind of a positive development, I mean, look at Europe, and Europe came up. It was the most sectarian place on earth just about 50 or 60 years ago. And two wars that were the most destructive in human history, and look at Europe today. So if in Europe things manage to move in this direction, and you have an EU with one government, it's not all that pretty at times. There are tensions, but still, the EU was established back in the 60s, and it's still operating. And that's Europe. If that could happen in Europe, this international cooperation can evolve in spite of all what happened. Maybe there is some hope for the Middle East. And the hope is that the Middle East will no longer be just the Middle East, but it would be some kind of a part of something which is more global. So I think if I would like to summarize what was said by the magnificent scholars, each speaking about a different country, is that there is much to be worried about present at present. But I think, and that's maybe even more personal than reflection on what was said, there is optimism in the future. So with this, I would like to end. Thank you.
The third panel concerned Israel and its relationship with Europe. And Mick Davis, who's also a member of the Board of Governors from London, will summarize that session.
You'll notice no academic qualifications to go with it, so I'll keep the session in a simple context of the fact that the terms of trade in Europe, in the context of Israel and its relationship, are going in the wrong direction. Now, while some people in the discussion had different views as to what the rate of that progression was, I don't think there's any dispute about the fact that we're entering more difficult territory in terms of the relationship of Israel and Europe. I think there's another important factor that one must take into account in the discussion of this, and that is the diaspora Jewish community in Europe as well, because they are more than the North American Jewish community impacted by this this direction of travel. So if one looks at what has taken place over the last few years in Europe, you will find, in fact, that generally the elites, the governing class, the business community, has essentially wanted a business-as-usual approach with Israel and have fought valiantly for that. And over time, as Israel's relationship with Europe, in fact, has reflected that, although there has been some delays in some of the agreements, the trade agreements, the academic agreements, nevertheless, these have come through. And there has been growing trade with Europe and growing relationships on the intelligence and military sphere as well. But public opinion has been moving in the opposite direction. So public opinion across the European Union, borne out by independent analysis and surveys and polling, has been a public which is becoming less and less patient with Israel and much more sympathetic with what they see to be the Palestinian predicament. What is happening now, it would appear, is that in the last couple of years, and reflected perhaps by votes in the international institutions like the United Nations, that governments are now moving in a way which is coalescing the direction of travel between where they were and where public opinion is. And that therefore Israel is therefore in danger of, I guess, losing Europe to some extent. So that was an important backdrop to this discussion, that you're in difficult circumstances. I think the other point to be made is that the prism with which the Israel is viewed is the prism of occupation and settlement activity. So if there wasn't the issue around occupation and settlement activity, we wouldn't be having this discussion. If we look at this, we therefore have a momentum where you have a public opinion which is talking about or part of a debate about boycotts. There is not a public opinion which is part of the debate about building a relationship with Israel. So it's not people on the one side saying we must build, and the other people on the other side saying we must exclude. The debate is about exclusion or non-exclusion. It's not about building the relationship again. That is not a good space to be in. So against that backdrop, many of the comments that that came out of this thing was to talk about two things. One is the fact that that Haifa University represents a part of society which is a microcosm of Israel in many respects, and reflects a society which functions in many times in a very positive and profoundly good way. So that is a plus point for the university positioning itself in this debate. But it also suggests, therefore, that Haifa University has a unique responsibility, given the fact that it is at the forefront of seeking an environment where it can, in fact, coexist and coexist productively across the various sections of Israeli society. It therefore has an obligation to see how it can actually translate that out in two ways. One is in terms of a potential projection of a more accurate picture of Israel within the European environment, and also to see how, in fact, it can lead movement and momentum within this country as well. So it's suggested there, in the terms of the discussion, that we do not understand what the disconnects are in Europe. We don't really understand what the value proposition or value propositions upon which European society is moving and distancing itself from Israel, and that we need to, in fact, undertake a body of research to understand that, and once we understand that, we can best able to respond to that. And here is a role, perhaps, that the university can play a part of, if not, in fact, a leading role. I think the other aspect is that there are many examples, while the governmental debate is one about sanctioning or criticizing Israel for its positions on occupation and settlements, and that takes place across Europe without fail, although some governments are more sympathetic than others. Nevertheless, there are examples, and particularly the United Kingdom, which I know well, where there are very special initiatives to create bilateral relationships, the building up of scientific contact, the building up of academic contact, the building up of trade, etc. And so again, it is potential, and was suggested in the panel, that this is an area which really institutions like the university should concentrate on building up these bilateral relationships. We cannot, in fact, control the dynamic on the political front, because that dynamic is, in essence, driven by policy options adopted by the Israeli government. And while we might want to change those, if we disagree with them, we're not in a position to give effect if they don't change. But we can affect key bilateral relationships, and we should not lose sight of that. And that's very important in maintaining a level of connectivity in a world where exclusion is becoming the main discourse or the prime discourse of the debate. And now let me turn a little bit to the Jewish community side of things. There is no doubt that European Jewish community, to different levels, feel much more embattled today than they did years ago. They're feeling a rise of anti-Semitism, perceived or real. And they feel excluded and they feel distant. And as Israel comes under pressure, and as the forces of building Israel into the sort of pariah state of the 21st century, if that gains any success or any momentum, those communities will feel even more pressurized and embattled. And I think that another thing, this is borne out also by the fact that they are aware that the perceptions of Jewish community loyalties within Europe by non-Jewish communities in Europe is such that they believe that Jews are more loyal to Israel than they are to the countries that they live in. They believe that they spend too much time concentrating on history, the Holocaust, etc. And so the Jewish community is recognizing, in fact, that they are facing a tougher street to operate in, and therefore, in fact, require or need far greater connection with Israel, where Israel, in fact, takes the lead, than has done in the past. And here again, I think, is an important role for the university to play. And that is building an ongoing, productive relationship with the Ashbury Jewish communities, which nurture those communities as they go through what I think will be a pretty traumatic few years going forward. I think that the overtures of a relationship where BDS is on the rise in Europe are there. So we're seeing small little vignettes coming through in the mood music, which gives light to that. There isn't any really a tangible form that we can place our hands on right now. We say the academic boycott is successful, the trade boycott is successful. It's not. It's all been spoken about. But the overture, I believe, is being played on a rising curtain where the Act One is certainly going to be of a Europe which is not in favorum of Israel. And that is something which we all need to respond to.
There is rationality in the order. I'm happy to call upon Manfred Lahnstein to speak on a more broad, reflective view of the relationship between Israel and Europe. Thank you.
I have to apologize. Until yesterday evening, I didn't know that I would be standing here. Because normally, Israel and Europe, 50 years of German-Israeli relations, former Ambassador Avi Primor, who has been an excellent ambassador of Israel, amongst others in Germany, and who didn't fall at all under the qualifications which have been made this morning, but Uzi Arad, he was an excellent diplomat. He fell ill, so I was asked yesterday evening if I could step in. I will try my best. I cannot make a coherent speech, but I would like to make perhaps 10 remarks which refer to the discussion, at least most of them, and which represent, as Avi would have done it, which represent my personal position. First remark about Israel and Germany. When I came to Israel the first time, it was in 1967. That's a long time ago. We went to Kibbutz Ginosar, not far away from Haifa. And it was a beautiful morning, and I was the first one to be awake. And Kibbutz Ginosar, where Yigal Alon lived at that time, whom we intended to visit, had a beautiful garden. And I was sitting in the garden, the birds were singing, and I hear behind my back, I hear two ladies speaking, and they were speaking not only German, they were speaking my home Rhenish, Rhinelandish dialect. And I was completely baffled. And I turned around, I would have liked to greet them and perhaps say a few friendly words. And when I turned around, both ladies had the Auschwitz number on their arms. And I didn't have the courage to greet them. 2 years afterwards, with my boss, a vice president of the European Commission, we went to Israel and we went to Yad Vashem. And since it was an official group of the European Commission, we were invited to lay down a wreath in Yad Vashem. And while doing so, my boss, who was quite a giant, convinced social democrat as I was, fainted. I came back to Israel with President Köhler. That is not such a long time ago, a couple of years ago. And he was the first German president who made it to Haifa, by the way. All the others, advised by the Foreign Office, stick to Jerusalem, go to Tel Aviv. But he made it to Haifa, upon my request, I must say. And we went to the Technion. And then he said in his short speech to the professors of the Technion, he said, if we can be of any help to you, please tell us so, we would be glad to do it. And then the president of Technion got up and said, Mr. President of Germany, if you ever need the help of us, please tell us, we will be glad to do so. We have come a long way, and yesterday evening I looked down from Dan Carmel Hotel down to the harbor, as I used to do for 45 years now, and watched one of the submarines, the Israel Navy, which we were talking about and which have been built in Germany. But let us perhaps step back a little further. As far as I see it, the foundation of the State of Israel in 1948 was based on the resolution of the United Nations in November 1947. The fulfillment of the Zionist dream. Herzl comes to my mind, Jabotinsky, who, by the way, I think, yes, he has his tomb in Kibbutz Hulda, where I go quite often, the Balfour Declaration and all that. I think of Sonia's father, who was kind of a Zionist, but a very special one, but who went to the Maccabiad in Haifa in the 30s. Why do I mention this? I personally believe that it is historically not correct to base the existence of the State of Israel on the Holocaust. Historically speaking, the Holocaust, of course, has been one of the defining elements of the State of Israel and its development, but not the only one. Israel is firmly based on an act of international law, November 47. It is based on its values and it's based on its achievements. This legitimacy cannot be questioned if we do not want to abolish international law as well. My country, the Federal Republic in Germany, after we had been liberated from the Nazi terror in 1945. We had to live with limited autonomy. We had artificial borders as well. We lost a large part of what once was Germany in the East. We acknowledged, not without pain, I must add, international law, even if it was imposed on us, for good reasons, by the way. And the same thing happened in 1990 when Germany was unified. It was based on acts of international law. So Germany as well is firmly based on international law, and this legitimacy cannot be questioned if we do not want to abolish international law itself. Second remark, and all the further remarks are a lot briefer. Legitimacy is not a one-way road. The UN resolution of 1947 calls for a Jewish and an Arab state on the territory was what was Palestine at that time. And as far as I can see it, neither 1967 nor 1973 have changed that. That leads immediately, as far as I am concerned, to the historic, the legal, and by the way, the political necessity for a two-state solution. By the way, the roadmap, we shouldn't quite forget it, just because perhaps we want to, has been signed not only by Russia or the European Union, but by Israel and the Palestinian itself. Two-state solution, which is a legal basis, and forgive me, but I remain convinced that solutions based on, in this case, international law are more valuable, more durable, more defendable than those based on, for instance, the Torah or the Bible or Islamic thought. But there are eminently practically and political reasons, of course, as well. I mentioned them earlier on. I know that a debate is developing again in Israel about a one-state solution, and your president spoke out in favor of a one-state solution very clearly in an interview which he gave just 2 weeks ago in a German major, weekly. I must say, I remain very, very negative, but baffled, and I ask myself how such a one-state solution can be based on international law. Of course, it can always be based on a new act of international law, but the basic condition for such a solution would be the complete equality of all its citizens in all respect. Now, I know the reality of the ground, like we all do. There will be no short-term peace solution. That is one of the conclusions of this morning as well. But we can hope for better situations. By the way, we have known better situations. In the year 2000, I visited Israel again with the then President Johannes Rau, by the way, honorary degree of Haifa University, and a strong supporter of Israel. And we went to Jenin. And north of the camp, or the city camp in Jenin, Palestinian, there was a common commercial and industry center being planned, and they started to build it, a common Palestinian-Israel center. Shimon Peres was the president for regional affairs. He consecrated this structure. And I still have a photo at home, spontaneous photo, of a Palestinian policeman and an IDF, young man from IDF, hugging arm in arm. That is not that long ago. And as I said earlier on, we should not become caught in history or in similar things. We should believe in the possibility to change. As far as Europe is concerned, I fully agree what has been said. That would have been my fourth remark, my fifth remark about Israel and in the Arab world. Unbelievable chaos. You know more about it than I do. I try to make an idea out of it. What is behind all that? And I come back to old Bernard Lewis, because I still find he has found the best explanation to this development some 20 years ago or so. There is a collective minority complex of most of the Arabs. A minority complex calls for compensation. Many times it calls for overcompensation. This can take harmless forms. You only have to look at Dubai skyscrapers to be aware of the fact. And there is reason for such a complex. What we tell our friends in Germany, the whole internal trade of the Arab League, 28 states, 10 years ago, now it has broken down even more, was less than the bilateral trade between Germany and Belgium, oil included. And the number of patents of all Arab, I'm not including Iran, of all Arab institutes of higher learning was less than the number of patents issued by Karlsruhe Technische Universität alone. There is reason for complex. But this means, my sixth observation, the Arab world is threatening Israel. The complex leads to compensation. And here I was really struck and impressed, and we should be what this morning has been said by Uzi about the new challenges which come upon us via via asymmetrical warfare and terrorism. And this can be directed at Israel at any given moment. When I look down from my window in Dan Carmel in 1967, I remembered Kibbutz Tel Katzir on the Lake Kinneret before the Six-Day Wars, when the Syrian tanks were sitting on the hills, dug in, and shot the farmers down in the valley. That was an immediate threat. But if you looked from Dan Carmel to the Lebanese border, you felt quite safe. We all know, especially in Haifa, how this has changed. The consequence for us: stand firmly and irrevocably behind Israel, its security, and its peaceful development, and fight all tendencies to delegitimize Israel, boycott included. Yesterday's Jerusalem Post, my seventh remark, there was an article, and in the article it is said, in the context of the boycott discussion, we are a strong country, not a weak shtetl dependent on its bread to a baker down the road. I think that is an absolutely correct remark. Yes, that is a fact, but if this should induce anybody into some form of splendid isolation, then it could become some kind of a shtetl. A question which is occupying us a lot in our practical work, and which has been mentioned again and again this morning included: can Jews and Arab live together? Professor Göring came up with a taxi driver from the Lake Kinneret, and this taxi driver was deeply convinced that was completely impossible. Given Arab fundamentalist beliefs, it couldn't be done. Last year I went with Majid Al-Hajj, we went to high schools in the Arab villages to talk to them, come to the University of Haifa, enter institutes of higher learning. A young boy of 16 gets up when I mentioned the Jewish presence in Jerusalem at Jesus' times and said, no, there have never been Jews in Jerusalem. I was completely baffled, of course, but then I found out that behind all the practical issues, we risk to be caught by our narratives. And the narratives, the deep narratives, are very, very different. And to some extent, they are antagonistic. They have to be changed. We had a discussion on this yesterday, and we can. And we can believe, of course, and our university is a prime example of it, that Jews and Arabs can live together. There I remain, after the discussion of this morning, I remained a restrained optimist. In my concluding remark, we have found wide differences of opinion yesterday, this morning, And thank God that that is so. But we should be clear, two things should not be negotiable. And by the way, not even intellectually or theoretically. One is human dignity. Human dignity, which has to lead to mutual respect. And the other one is the quest for knowledge at a university. But the quest for knowledge has to lead to absolute modesty, intellectual modesty included. So that is my reaction to the debate. That is my reaction to our presence. That is my reaction to a good experience of 50 years of German-Israeli relations. And I hope my remarks have been sufficiently coherent, and Avi will not be angry with me. Thank you very much.
Manfred, you never disappoint. Never. Thoughtful, intelligent, informed. So, as you would say, so, I open the floor for discussion, further comment, further questions, further observations. The subject is never exhausted. I will give you an offhand comment. When I proposed this topic for discussion, there was some resistance. In fact, anything I say, there's some resistance. I suppose I'm getting to the point, if I don't get resistance, then it's completely meaningless. But it was very interesting that some reactions were nervous about having this discussion. It was too political, too volatile, what have you. And I countered very easily that if we cannot have these discussions in these halls, where in fact can we discuss anything? And so we gathered, and there was some lively discussions. And it occurred to me how deeply ignorant I am. Now, I'm a reasonably informed individual, not as well informed as my wife, but I get a lot of information from her, so it helps. But in general, these discussions highlight how little I know. And one of the responses I have, of course, is to be more diligent about becoming better informed. I spend a fair amount of time in the United States. Most of the year we're here, but some of the time we're there. And I live in a community of normal people. These normal people live in a region north of Boston, about 100 miles north of Boston. And occasionally they talk to me. And occasionally the conversation centers on Israel, the Middle East, American relations with the world. My level of ignorance pales to theirs. Their ignorance about where Israel even is, not to refer to the particularities of our problems, is extraordinary. I mean, it's absolutely mind-bending how little they understand or know. And this is the American public, which is, of course, so important in defining, framing, orienting American policy. And the job that we have to keep ourselves informed, plus keeping them informed, is just enormous. And each of us has a responsibility, I would say, first of all, to be informed, but for what purpose? Well, obviously for electoral politics and election and all that, but also as members of this community, of the university community, we have a responsibility to educate, to inform, to keep people aware of our problems. And I would say, don't worry, it's just noise. I would say that one of the take-home messages, at least for me, in a personalized way, is to recognize that Israel has always been under an existential threat. It's hard to say if it's worse or better than it has been. But the responsibility, and I always refer to this as a responsibility, for being a citizen is to being engaged, to being informed, and to help support Israel in the most mundane way, letting the world know what's going on. And so in that regard, I encourage you each to become better informed, except for our experts, of course. They're very well informed. And to recognize this responsibility for educating others as well. Okay, that's my editorial comment. Please.
Manfred, I was a little bit surprised why you were so skeptical about the one-state solution. Because when I take the example of Haifa University seriously, then I must think about the one-state solution, because this example does not really play into the hand of a two-state solution, but into the hand of a one-state solution.
Here we are dealing with an Israeli university. Here we are dealing in a very precise framework. Here we are dealing within the framework of a very precise constitution.
That is completely different. That is completely different. Here we have a situation where we are probably even fond of the fact that we have a 25% Arab student population. A fully evolving one-state solution for the country around us would mean a situation where within a relatively short distance, the Jewish population would be in a minority situation. And this runs clearly, first of all, it runs against the, if I remember it correctly, against the Declaration of Independence and against the will of the, as far as I can see it, the absolute majority of the Jewish people. I think it's dangerous to leave the path of a two-state solution. I would still defend it.
Can I add something with your permission? I think that we are much closer to Europe than to America. It is a viable concept for an American. If I understand, no matter how big is the Turkish minority in Germany, you will not accept the idea that German will not be the language and Germany will not be the state of the German people.
Well, it's been for 800 years or 1,200.
Okay, no, it's in our case, it's more than 5,000 years. It depends, you know. Each of us start to count somewhere in the history. So, and then I accept Manfred's views. As long as we shall find the right balance between understanding the concept of a state for the Jewish people. On the other side of the border, there will be a state for the Palestinian people. This is the ideal concept. And hopefully they will have a Jewish minority in Palestine, and we know that we shall have an Arab Palestinian minority in Israel. Hopefully there will be a democracy. We want to assure you that we will be a democracy. So this is the only viable concept that I can support. And I believe that this is only the only viable, you know, concept that it is, you know, we can imagine in Israel, just to finish, look, I don't know how many millions were killed in hundreds of years in Europe in order to achieve an arrangement between church and state. Judaism and Islam have not reached this point. And it is very, very difficult. I'm sure that probably some researchers here can explain much better than I do the problem of how many years it will take for Judaism to accept the very, very complicated concept of separate between the tradition, religion, theology, and statehood. I'm sure that it will not be a shorter process than for the Muslims. But Christianism is in a different level. It will not work in the Middle East of today. This is my belief.
Thank you. Yefet.
Comments or questions? no other comment.
No, go ahead, Charles.
No. Keep the audience there, because in every case I will say something.
Well, since I have you, are there suggestions for topics for next year? Yes, Mark.
First of all, I'd like to compliment you for taking the initiative on behalf of some members. I can't speak for everybody, because it gave the board an opportunity to participate. You took the challenge of a hot topic. One thing we may want to discuss in future years, the internal conflicts within Israel. Again, another emotionally challenging topic. But I'd also like to say to ex-president Manfred, that was one of the best speeches I've heard you ever deliver. Today.
The issue about Israeli democracy is a very pressing one.
Democracy versus theocracy.
That's one way to frame it. Yes. Excuse me?
Celebrating peace.
Yeah. Okay. You know, this is what happens after you have lunch and talk all morning. I hope you found it interesting, stimulating, and much to think over. Peter?
Fred, I think there may be a need to revisit this subject again next year.
Maybe so. Thomas, did you want the last word?
No, it's not the last word. I can be up, you know. Give me the stage.
Go ahead.
Your comment, you know, that you said about, you know, that the University of Haifa actually represents the ability of one state solution. And I must tell you that I was struck by this comment because I was not prepared and I said it, right? Because logically, you are right. Yeah? And it took me, you know, some seconds, you know, to recover in order, you know, to remain in my previous position. You know, this is...
You had to recover.
Yeah, and I thought about it, and I totally agree with what, you know, what I understood Abi meant. And as I said, you know, what I understood is the reality in the Middle East, because yes, in utopia, you know, in ideal world, you know, even the idea of state, of countries, is irrelevant, you know, because everyone could live everywhere. So the whole idea of nations, the whole idea of religion, different people, you know, is irrelevant, you know. And so if you make a poll now in Israel, and this is this is not my guess, and you ask, you know, the against or favor two-state solution, most of them will be on favor with two-state solution. And why is that? Because they are afraid of one-state solution. And why is that? Because most Israelis, first of all, would like to keep the culture, the dominance, you know, of the Jewish, as a Jewish state. Not that most of them are racist or whatsoever. It's, I mean, you know, as most of the German probably would like to maintain the German culture. And also, there is another issue. You know, and I represent, you know, I don't say what is my view. It doesn't really matter. As I always say, the university doesn't have political view. Individuum within the university has political views, and this is a difference. You know, Israelis, you know, if you ask, you know, some of the Israelis or more, they are afraid because they see a one-state solution as a first stage of the near the destruction of Israel. This is the source of the fear. And as I say, I don't say what is my opinion about it. I just say, you know, if I can interpret the majority of Israelis, this is the case.
Okay, on that happy note, I'm going to join this session, and the bus is waiting for us, or is there more? Okay, good.
Thank you.
you again to Professor Tauber and to Professor Mannheim and to the chairs of the discussion groups and to the Viserys Institute and to all of you and to everyone who made this day possible. We're left with some concern, with a lot to do, and thankfully with some optimism. So my administrative announcement for you is that the buses for the PhD conferment ceremony leave for the Carmel Center at 4:15 prompt. And they asked me to emphasize the promptness in order to catch the beginning of the ceremony. And they should already be waiting for you. The coaches should be waiting for you in the parking lot to this building by the fourth floor exit. And so with that, we conclude today's session. Thank you all very much.